Morning, everybody. Welcome to the show. Here we are. TownTV's stood in the middle of Popham Airfield, surrounded by microlights and all those sorts of things. But today is the first day of Phamie's challenge, and somebody rang in and said, why doesn't Phamie McDonald go wingwalking? And that's what she's going to do in just a minute. I'll go and get the very nervous Phamie in just a second, but thanks all of you who turned out to watch the Andover Carnival. Sorry it was such a downpour. We were filming, and we put up our huge stage in front of the Guildhall, but it was wet. And it was more than wet, it was dreadful. But anyway, we're going to bring you some shots of that we took, or he managed to take, without Jason drowning. And on with the show, that's all I can say. But where are those crunchies? Where's Phamie McDonald? Is she nervous? I'm going to go and find out. Good morning.
Morning, Al. All I can do is giggle.
Is that nerves?
Yeah.
Nerves.
Whoever rang in and asked me to do this, I hate you.
Wing walking. Phamie McDonald wing walking?
Well, if you're a regular watcher of the show, you'll know, and you know, Al, that I'm fascinated with planes and anything that flies. What you don't know is...
I thought you were talking about pilots.
Oh, yes, pilots as well. They come with a job, I'm sure. Yes. Well, what you might not know is I'm absolutely petrified of heights, and I've got a real fear of falling. So this
have
is.
You've done parachute jumping?
Yes, and I hated every minute of it. It was to try and get over my fear of falling and my fear of heights, but it didn't work. It made it worse.
Never mind.
This challenge has had me on the loo all morning, but I'm going to do it. And I must say, if you're going to ring in with a challenge, if I don't do the challenge, you can give me a forfeit. And can I also just say, if you want to ring in and set one of your friends up for a challenge, we'll storm into their workplace with our cameras, grab them, take them somewhere, and make them do something that they've always wanted to do. So if you've got a challenge for a friend or you want to challenge me to do something, then give us a call. What's the number?
Andover 390.
390.
Or Salisbury 555.
222.
Or you can send us a fax on Andover 390.
391.
That's it. Dead right. Very good. So, anyway, Phamie will do the dangerous ones. We won't make you do, you know, the dangerous, really dangerous ones.
No, I'm properly insured.
Yeah.
And I am trained.
I will be trained. Somebody wants you to climb the north face of the Eiger, I think.
With a carnation up my nose. Thanks then, everyone.
Anyway, here we go. On with the show. Thanks for watching. Bye for now. Bye, Phamie. It's lovely to have met you.
Yes, it's been...
Bye. Bye. You can stand there on your own. Bye. Bye. Phamie, you're going to be up there in a minute.
I feel fine. I'm fine. Where's the toilet?
That's twice you mentioned the toilet. Never mind, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it.
They look splendid.
They look great. If you look in this, the reflection on this propeller, this wonderful Pratt & Whitney engine, you'll see Jason on camera. And he is actually going to go up and do some air-to-air photography. So this is going to be really good. You're going to be actually see Phamie screaming her head off from very close. I don't know, about 5,000 feet, but should be quite good fun. You don't mind going up, do you, Jason?
No, not at all.
Not at all. What a heroes we are at Town TV. So anyway, we're just waiting for Phamie to come back. Kitted up and a bit of a lesson on how to wing walk, and off she goes. So we'll see you in just a second.
Right, so this is the guy that's going to be piloting me. What's your name?
Mike Dentith.
Mike Dentith, the pilot.
That's right.
Looking after me very well. So, I'm in the process of being kitted up.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to be shown all around the plane and the harness and how all that works.
Right.
What kind of things will I be facing up there?
Well, yeah, hopefully today, because it's not very warm, one of the things you won't be facing is lots of bugs hitting you.
Yes, I'm worried about flies in my eyes.
You don't have to worry about that, because they only come out in the warm weather. So if you smile, which you will, because you won't be able to help it, the thing to do is to grate your teeth so you don't actually eat any.
Unless, do I pick them all out when I get down? Like, pick all the flies out of my teeth?
Yes, you'll need to do that. But no, so there shouldn't be too many today, so that's all right. And we're going to give you a rather smart pair of skydiving goggles, so you shouldn't get anything in your eye.
Right, well, you're going to show me around the plane. Would you like to just take me over and show me what's what? This is a splendid plane.
It's a lovely aircraft. It's a Boeing Stearman, which is a 1940s American training airplane. It's the sort of American equivalent to the English Tiger Moth, the famous Tiger Moth. And this was built in serious number. It was on order from the American government. They ended up building 12,000 of these aeroplanes for training pilots, particularly American all forces pilots. And in fact, there were some British pilots that were also trained in Canada and America that then subsequently went on to fly Spitfires.
Right. Has there been much adaptation done to this plane to make it...
Yeah, there's some big changes. The basic airframe is exactly the same as it was. It came from the factory with a 220 horsepower Continental engine, and these have got double that. They've got 450 horsepower, because obviously when you're up there and that rig's up there, that's like a huge windbreak. So the more power we have to get you off the ground, the better.
I was told we were at the Wallop International Air Show filming you flying there, and I was told the wingwalkers have to be quite small.
Ideally, yeah. And the smaller they are, the less of a windbreak they are, and much easier for us to fly. So we're not looking for somebody who's particularly large to go up there. So the smaller you are, the better. And you're a good size.
That's good.
You're a great size.
I'm glad about that. Right, well, while you prepare the plane for me to fly, I'm going to go and speak to Vic. Now, he is the guy who is the boss of the team, and I'd like to talk to him about how long he's been going and what kind of things this Crunchy Flying Circus does. Vic, hi, morning.
Hi there, morning to you.
You're the boss of this team, aren't you?
Yep.
You are. So how long has this team been up and running, and who started it?
Well, this is our seventh season.
Right.
With Cadbury's Crunchy, and I started it 7 years ago.
You started it yourself?
Yeah.
And it's a very small team, isn't it? There's only four or five of you, isn't there?
Well, there's a small team here, but actually back at base to support these aircraft, we do a lot of flying. We did 91 shows last year. We've got two full-time engineers and two full-time PR girls, because it's the PR side that matters as far as our sponsors are concerned. So. Right. You just see us here with the two aeroplanes, but actually back at base there's quite a big support that's going on.
So have you ever wing walked yourself?
No.
So you're going to be piloting the cameras plane.
Yes.
This is Jason.
Hi, Jason.
And this is the man who's going to be piloting you. So that's fabulous. I can't wait. I've always wanted to do this. Yeah, I saw you
must
in a...
be mad.
I must be. I must be absolutely crazy, but we'll see when I come down. I saw you in a magazine, not you personally, but I saw the team in a magazine years ago, and I always thought I'd love to do that, and now it's my dream come true, and I'm really happy. Thank you ever so much for taking me today.
Well, we're delighted that you're going to have a flight with us, and I'm sure you'll enjoy it.
Yes, so will I. One more time to the toilet, and then off we go. If you were watching Middle Wallop International Air Show, you'll remember Helen Tempest. She's the lovely lady who came off the wing walk and I interviewed and said, Helen, can I have a go? And here I am.
It's happening, isn't it? Well done.
I didn't expect it to happen so fast. So what are you going to do now?
Well, I've got a very sexy hat for you and some even lovelier gloves. And I'm going to kick you up in this. And then Tania is going to attach you to the top of the aeroplane.
Right. Now, how long have you been doing this?
Oh, a long time.
Long time.
Yes, I've been with Vic since the inception of the team, and then I used to fly with my dad on Tiger Moths before that. So,
So you're used to being up in the air then?
Yes, it's my second home up there. I get confused if I'm not allowed to fly.
Right, let's get kitted up in this caboodle then.
Hold gloves. It protects your ears mainly from the wind. So that goes over there like that.
And is it true I might get flies in my mouth?
Oh, definitely, yes, if it's that kind of day. But
do you smile when you're up there?
Love it. Well, Tony and I are usually shouting at each other. I mean, not that we can hear, but we're usually screaming and shouting at each other. Right, there you go.
core.
Pixie, Phamie.
I look like a pixie, he said.
And the goggles are tinted to protect your eyes from the sun.
Lovely.
So we think of everything here. Now, pop the gloves on when you get up there,
right?
Because so that you can grip onto everything. It's like climbing up a giant stepladder. That's the fun bit, getting you up there.
Is there anything I shouldn't do?
Okay, well...
I can't hear actually what you're saying to me because I've got these things over my ears.
What you need to do is Tania will strap you in, and there's a locking pin up on the wing. So that means that you are attached totally to the top wing. You can't get out by accident. Mm-hmm. And we will then, when you land, we will come and get you out, which means that you're nice and safely secured whilst the propeller's running, which is the important thing. We don't want you wandering off into running propellers.
No, I don't think I want to.
That's dangerous, that is. So we attach you to the aeroplane and you are safe until you get down, and we will come and rescue you. Now, the main thing is that Mike can see you all the time. He gets a wonderful view of your bottom, which makes the thrill of his day. And so he can see you at all times. He will shout at you before you take off, "Are you all right?" And you go, "Yes." And then he can see your thumbs up. If you're not happy at any time, it doesn't matter whether you're on the ground or in the air, at any time you're not happy, both arms out, thumbs down, and then he can see you and he'll come and land and we'll have a chat about maybe what's wrong.
Right.
But hopefully you'll be just laughing your head off and giggling to your cameraman.
And swallowing flies.
Yes, and he'll be flying in the other aeroplane in the front seat, so you'll be looking at him and waving and maybe kicking a leg in the air or whatever you want to. So all you have to remember is once you're in, you're very safe and secure. You don't need to hold on, you can just wave and enjoy yourself.
Brilliant. Well, let's get in this plane then before I change my mind.
Well, first thing to remember is this is a fabric aeroplane.
Right.
Okay, so if you put your foot on there, it's going to go through the fabric. So you need to only step on the places marked out and the places that I'll show you.
Yeah.
Okay, so first thing is put your hand on there, foot up here, and pull yourself up.
Yep.
So that you're standing on the black bit marked out. Come on.
I'm dignified, aren't I?
Right, I think what I'll do is if I go up first and show you where I'm standing.
Right.
And then you can follow me up. So first thing is there's handles here and here.
Yep.
For you to use should you need them. You put your foot on the back of the seat there. Like that.
Yep.
And hold on to this strut here. Stand up on there, put your heel on there. You can step on any of that semicircle, but not on the glass. If you step on the glass, you'll crack it. Okay. And you kneel with one knee on there. Put your arm through so that you're holding on, and your other arm on the wire.
Yeah.
Bring your other knee up so you're kneeling. And then you bring this leg round until it's on the black.
Yep.
And your other leg up. And there you go.
So there we are. What do you think, viewers? Do you think she's going to enjoy this? Would you enjoy doing that? I'm sure you would, but we're going to let you know in a minute. Just about to take off. Having a final lesson, so I shall stand back because they're going to start the engines in a minute. So see you in a minute. There's our great TownTV battle wagon. At about 4 o'clock last Saturday afternoon, we decided to head back to Andover to help the roadies and all the crew setting up the stage for the great Andover Carnival. They're working very hard, all the roadies there. Anyway, speeding down the A303, the weather was absolutely beautiful. Look, not a cloud in the sky. Anyway, we'd contacted Stagecraft and a few other companies to put up a huge stage for us, right outside the Guildhall. There it goes. These are amazing. Just blow them up in about 4 minutes and up they go. And it was a good job. It was a very, very good job. We decided to do that. Because if you went to Andover Carnival, you all know what happened next. further it was. We parked up in Charlton Road in Andover, and the only thing Jason could do was actually film through the window screen. It was absolutely teeming down, but Advert there put on a really good show. Look at them, they're enjoying themselves around the cover with a septic peg. Very good indeed. Good heavens, what do you call that, Jason? I think you call that a penny farthing, but he must have been wet. Everybody's sheltering there, just by the hospital. Who we got here? I'm not quite sure who they are. Don't know very well, though, do they? Really colourful floats this year, though. Everybody made an effort, but I don't think there are many walkers about, because by now it was getting harder and harder. We all thought it was going to stop. And then they were transport with a shooting range. We all thought it was going to stop raining, but it didn't. As I say, it just got harder and harder and harder. And that's the Red Hot Ghost Train. And this looks like Simon Probyn from Probyn Music and the New Antonian Swing Orchestra. Yes, it is. Well, they're having a good time anyway. I recognise a few of those people. And to you too. It's Hawaiian Coconut Shy. Big thanks to all these transport companies around Andover who actually donate their lorries free of charge for this. Here's a great float from the Royal Oak in Charlton. There's our friend Carol on the back. Hello, Carol. Yes, thank you very much. A lot of hardy youngsters out there. There's a Royal Oak again. There, look, even in all this rain, people sit outside. Look at that rain. Police ride on show, doing a great job as usual. And still the rain didn't put people off. I mean, look, it's just absolutely pouring. I'm sure his radio's got soggy. Here comes the rain again. They were outside the bingo hall. Big wave from everybody there. They're in the dry. Also, big cheer from the station hotel as we went past. They don't look wet, do they? Good crowd outside Safeways. I think one thing which was a problem this year, that everybody in the procession was required to go up to Smanor. Well, that's an awfully long way. So we at Town TV decided to do something about that, just to give them sort of a halfway stop. So we tried to recreate the Mardi Gras spirit in the High Street. And that was the stage you saw going up earlier. Look at that rain. And there's the amateur photographer. So just around the corner from the High Street, we drove into the upper High Street, and you'll see shortly our huge tent. And we had live karaoke from Take One Karaoke. It was absolutely splendid. But it rained. And it kept on raining, and raining, and raining, and raining.
July, on VH1. We're out on the road with Summer in the City. First off, we head north to Glasgow and Dundee to meet Ricky Ross, Lorraine Kelly, Delamitri, and a look back at the Eurythmics. Then cross the border to Newcastle with Sting, Jimmy Nail, Dave Stewart, and Dire Straits Live. In Sheffield are Def Leppard, Prince Nazim, The Human League, and Lisa Stansfield. Finally, we arrive at the capital with Shane Ritchie, David Essex, Chaz and Dave, and concerts with Ian Dury and the Blockheads, and the original Britpoppers, The Kinks. The road brings the best in new country with the likes of Emmylou Harris, Sean Colvin, Travis Tritt, and the slightly strange Run C&W. Sounds of the 60s brings its retrospective look to a close, and then hands over to the 70s, where everything goes to 11. More volume, more colour, and more makeup. All this plus madness of the Artist of the Month, Don't Miss In-Depth Lunacy, and 17 years worth of videos. That's July on VH1, music that means something.
Order Garage have a very special announcement to make. This ad is not too good to be true. No matter what credit problems you may have had, we can and will help. Phone us on our hotline, 01264 357 144, or visit us. We are open 7 days a week. It really is as simple as that.
Nestle Cheerios, multi-grain nutrition. Never. Tasted so good.
Nestle Cheerios, the goodness of corn, oats, rice and wheat in deliciously light crispy O's. When you try them, you'll say...
Multigrain.
Nutrition.
Never tasted
so good.
Told you.
Multigrain nutrition never tasted so good.
Today we've given our hero Mr. Muscle Bathroom Cleaner to tackle that tight mark.
Uh-oh.
Look out! Yuck! With a spray of new improved Mr. Muscle... A wipe... And a quick rinse, your bathroom's sparkling clean. Mr. Muscle loves the jobs you hate.
A summer Sunday at Amport in Hampshire. Glorious cricket washed intently by all around the boundaries and the pavilion. The sound of leather on willow, crisp-pressed white flannels against a background of Amport House. A time to relax. A time to unwind. But just a minute. This is more than a sunny Sunday snooze. This is the National Village Cricket Knockout Competition. And Amport are through to the last few against Barnes Green from Sussex. Visitors Barnes Green needed just 121 to beat Amport. And sadly, for us, they did this with 5 overs to spare. And with a loss of just 1 wicket. Lord's Cricket Ground had beckoned for Amport. But Amport was stumped. Never mind, what a wonderful day to watch cricket in the Hampshire countryside. Time for tea, anybody?
Hello, if you were watching last week, you would have seen the start of a very interesting competition. Spire FM launched a competition called Hands Off My Courser, and the prize is, well, it's a courser. What did the contestants have to do, Ian? Just to recap for the people who didn't see this last week.
Well, we whittled down 2 weeks ago now, it would be, finalists down to 10, and the 10 finalists had to turn up here at, it was about 6:30 on a Friday morning, and lay one of their hands on the car and basically stay there, and the last person left touching the car gets to drive it away.
So, how long have they been stood here?
So far they have been stood here for 20, 7 hours and 20 minutes.
27 hours, and they're pretty desperate for this car, obviously.
They are. They really want to win this car. It's a beautiful car. It's well worth winning. And, of course, now we're down to 7 out of the 10.
So what happened to the other three?
One person got frightened by a daddy long legs and went, like that. It's my birthday today, and somebody else...
Happy birthday.
Thank you. Somebody else grabbed the microphone and said, happy birthday, everybody, and then suddenly realised that he'd taken his hand off. And one person just found it a little bit too much and started to feel dizzy, so, you know, did the right thing and pulled out.
So there's 7 left, and they're not moving.
They are not moving. They are not going
to
budge.
Right, so we're going to go inside and talk to some of these people that are left and see how they're feeling. They should be pretty tired by now, I should think. 27 hours, that's a pretty long time to hold on to a car. So what's been going through your mind while you've been stood here?
Well, there are highs. There have been highs and lows. Long as I can get through the lows, then a high seems to follow on behind. But
when did the lows come?
That's it. It was during the night, really. You know, you've got, it's dark out. It's quiet. Obviously, everyone else is in bed,
including me.
Yeah. So that was the worst time, but so the team spirit's been brilliant. At one point, there was like 7 of us doing crosswords, trying to keep each other awake. You know,
so have you all got to know each other quite well?
Yes, we have. Yeah, yeah.
That's brilliant. So you're lifelong friends because you've stood around this car for 27 hours.
Now. Oh, absolutely. Yes, it's definitely an experience that you know, I wouldn't. I'm not going
to
forget.
What happened to the man who was stood here? No, it was a lady, wasn't it? Stood here next to you.
It was a man.
It was the man stood here. What happened to him?
He was singing happy birthday to Ian Axton, and he lifted his hand off when he cheered everybody on to sing along with him.
Oh, that is not fair! That's not fair, but he must have been gutted.
He was. It was all
tiredness that makes you forget.
I think so, yes. Yeah.
So what's been going through your mind when you've been stood here?
Why am I doing this? I do need this car. I desperately need this car.
Do you have a car at the moment?
Yes, fallen to pieces.
So you want a new one?
Want a new one, desperately.
So you're hanging on, you're staying here?
I'm hanging on, I'm staying here, yes.
Would you like to hear the alarm go off?
I'd love to hear the alarm go off.
Well, most people would. I think there was only one person who said they'd like to sit it out for the rest of the time.
No. I think I'd be ready for that alarm, yes.
They've all had enough, they want to hear that, they're desperate for that alarm. So, well, good luck, hope you win the car. I think you're all very, very brave, and I couldn't do it myself. This is the lady. I've got to speak to this lady here. She stood just off camera. This is Dragonfly Lady. Sorry to call you that.
It was a crane fly, one of those horrible.
So you'd been stood there how long?
Well, I was there 20 or 21 hours, and it was 3:15 this morning. I'd just finished my break, and I came back to the car, just put my hand down, and somebody said, there's a dragonfly, and I looked round to see a dragonfly, and it was a crane fly, and I hate them. And I went to swipe it away, and there was the hand gone.
No, you must have been absolutely gutted.
I didn't know whether to laugh or cry at the time, to be quite honest. But once I got home and I thought about it, and we had some consolation prizes. And
what did you get as a consolation prize?
Beautiful bouquet of flowers and a bottle of bubbly as well. So, and then I tried to go to sleep when I got home, but
beyond sleep now.
I couldn't sleep, so I came back down again.
You come back down to support everybody, haven't
yes,
you?
I did, yes.
I'm here with Anne. She's the only lady who opted to sit on the floor. How are you feeling?
All right, I've got a numb bum, but
I bet you have.
But it's so numb, I can't feel it. So,
what's been going through your mind when you've been sat here?
You just keep thinking lots of different things and changing position, and
you're not allowed to swap hands, are you?
No.
What were the rules that were given to you before you came here?
You put your hand on. No other part of your body can touch the car except the hand. You can't lean or. And that's it.
That's it.
It stays on.
You can't swap hands, you can't change position, you can't move around the car, slide your hand around the car.
No.
So you opted to sit down. Why was that?
It just better for me, suits me better. So I'd be out if I was stood now.
So you've been here 27 and a bit hours. How much longer do you think you can keep hanging on?
Till the end. I'm staying.
Till the bitter end.
Well, welcome back to the final of Hands Off My Corsa 1996, and we have been here for 30 hours. Yay! We started out with 400 semi-finalists. We whittled those down to 10. We now have just 7 people left with their hands on the car. They mustn't take their hands off. If they do, they're out of the competition. Or indeed, an alarm could sound at any time. We set the alarm at 7 a.m. yesterday morning. It hasn't sounded yet. It could happen at any time. If that does, we're into a tie-break situation for the biggest radio prize in South Wiltshire and West Hampshire. From Spire FM and Lex Vauxhall, this is Hands Off My Corsa. We had thousands of callers that wanted to take part in this competition. We whittled it down to 400. You got into the final 10, then to the final 7. You don't want to take your hand off, do you?
No, she's
well, I'm afraid it's true. We are in a tie-break situation. So a round of applause for Liz Rock from Salisbury. And she takes her hand off the course. Take it seriously. Joe! Well, the battle will end in round about 3 minutes' time. We've been here for 30 and a half hours at the Lake Showroom in Southampton Road. We have 7 finalists who refuse to take their hands off the car. We are now in a tie-break situation. For the last time, a very hearty cheer of congratulations for everyone because they are all winners. The tie-break situation that we have in store is basically the price of the car. We asked all the contestants 30 and a half hours ago to estimate how much they think the car is worth, including 12 months road tax, 3 years servicing, and a full tank of petrol. Everybody has had a guess. It was in a sealed envelope for the last 30 and a half hours. We've opened those envelopes. Eddie Nags, in his hand, has the exact price of the car. And the exact price of the Lex Vauxhall Corsa with 12 months road tax, 3 years servicing, and a full tank of petrol for the Spire FM listener is going to win is, Eddie, £7,735.31. And that means that the winner is Liz Rolfe from Salisbury.
I just want to say, Liz, well done. This is Liz. She's the lady who won the car. Was it all worth it?
Oh, yes, definitely.
You said just now it was the dancing that kept you going.
Definitely the dancing, yes.
And the tiebreaker was you made a guess how much the car cost plus petrol plus servicing warranty. Was it an educated guess or was it a completely wild guess?
It was a semi-educated guess, but then I never buy petrol, so I didn't know how much petrol costs, so I sort of had to guess that one.
So it was a complete guess.
And insurance I wouldn't have known, so it was a guess.
Yeah.
It was.
I saw the look on your face when you won, you couldn't believe it.
I don't believe it.
Because earlier on when the alarm sounded and Ian said to you, you can take your hands off car, you were there saying, no, I don't believe you, I'm not moving.
No, that's right.
Well, your determination's got you through and you've got the car, so what you have to do now is clean the fingerprints off.
Yes, I want to keep the labels though.
Bless you, to keep the labels on. Well done, enjoy your new car.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm with Eddie now, he's from Lex Vauxhall. Eddie, how much of a hand have you had in this competition?
Well, about 3 or 4 months ago we started to plan it, and Ian Axton and Gary and I have been working on it, coming up with the mechanics and how it will work. And it all come together when 2 days ago when we got the car into the showroom and all the staff got behind me and got things moving for us.
So this is partly your idea?
It's a joint Spire FM and Lex idea. And
whose actual idea was it to have people put their hands on the car and stand there till they couldn't take it any longer?
I would like to go so far as to say it was Ian, myself and Gary's.
It's very cruel.
I'm not going to say it was Gary, but it could be any one of us.
Take your pick. Well, it seems to have gone very well. They've had a lot of support, haven't they, down here?
Oh, absolutely tremendous. The actual support from the community, as is always very good in Salisbury.
It's gone very well. Poor car's a little bit grubby, so before the winner drives it away, is it going to be cleaned?
I think before August the 1st, the P-registered Corsa will be clean and balloted and ready to roll.
Excellent. Well, thanks a lot, Eddie. Thanks for having us down here today, and brilliant competition.
We
really enjoyed it.
You're welcome.
Thank you. down to the cattle market in Salisbury to meet with an old friend. Aubrey Steele is the man responsible for hundreds of deaths on the road by letting me loose with the car. Actually, no, I haven't had any crashes. Hi, Aubrey. How are you this morning?
I'm fine, thank you.
The reason I've come down is I want to know, and lots of other people want to know too, I missed it, but there's a new theory test been brought in, hasn't there, to go alongside the driving test?
Yes, 1st of July it came in, been phased in from the 1st of June. But yes, a 35-question paper.
So it's actually a sit-down written test to go alongside your physical driving test, is that right?
No. Sit down, tick your box.
Sit down, tick your box. So what kind of questions are being asked in this test?
Attitude questions, road behaviour questions, road maintenance questions, or vehicle maintenance questions. Things to do with driving, you know, anything to do with driving. Whereas the old question format, which was only half a dozen verbal by the examiner, were very much a few signs, three questions on what happened to be the flavour of the month at the time.
Yeah, so why do you think this new test has been brought in?
EC directive.
Oh, lovely.
Technically under the banner of road safety, but like anything, everybody's only forced to do things because other people tell them they must.
Hasn't Europe had a written test for some time now?
I'm not sure how many years, yes, but a lot of years.
And they think it works, so we've had to do it as well.
Whether it works or whether it doesn't work is not the issue. They say we have to have it.
Do you think it will work?
I think it will work very well. I think that if the public actually look at it sensibly, they'll realise it will actually cut down the cost of learning to drive, and it will also make them safer drivers.
Yeah.
Because as we were, the driving instructor put in the information relevant to getting them through the test, rather than them having the information relevant to being safe drivers.
Right. So now you're going to have to learn a whole new set of things that you probably wouldn't, you'd probably skip over before.
Yes. Yes.
So it will make you a safer driver.
Well, should do if they take the information in and retain it and understand it, which I think they'll have to understand it to a reasonable level to be able to tick the right questions on the right boxes.
Yeah. So apart from the new theory test, what other kind of changes is that going to bring for the whole driving test experience?
The new licence holder won't be allowed to tow anything.
Like caravans and trailers and things?
No, that's a separate practical test and a very short, small, separate theory test.
Right.
They also won't be allowed to drive up to 7.5-ton lorries.
Which you currently are?
Yes, yes, you can go up to 7.5 tons gross. They'll only be allowed to drive up to 3.5 tons gross.
Right.
Which is going to put some of the big 4x4 people in their horse boxes in and big caravan owners and that into big awkward situations.
So this is going to mean a lot of changes for driving tests and driving in general?
Yes, yes, it's going to mean that, I mean, everybody is going to be better trained because they're going to be tested to a certain lower standard.
Right.
So we've got no more of, oh, I fancy a caravan, hitch it up and drive off up the road.
You have to take a test first.
Yes. Wow. And there's lots of people out there that wouldn't pass it. They've been towing caravans for many years. Although the caravan club do their best.
These new changes in the whole driving test experience, how are they going to affect you as a driving school?
They're going to make things a little more, I can say complicated, but not complicated, but it's going to have to be more precisely organised, which is going to be better for us because we're going to have to organise our clients a little more.
Right.
But it is going to give us an awful lot more work, both on administration and on the practical front, which is obviously where we make our living. The theory test itself costs £15, so we're not talking an immense amount of money there. You should be able to study for it yourself, really. There's no reason. All the literature is available from most bookshops, so that's just time. But in reality, people haven't got time. So we're probably going to have to help them with it. So I would think it's probably pushed the costs up by about 10%.
Gosh, that's quite a lot, isn't it?
Yeah, and also the something that I don't think general public have actually considered is the driving test now is just a shade longer. Because they don't have to ask those questions at the end of the test, which in itself will, to drive for an extra 2 or 3 minutes, means you need to be that slightly higher standard of driving again. So for your average person, yeah, another couple of lessons, I would think, just to make sure you can retain your driving skills?
Well, I've just recently passed my test, so I won't have to go through this, thankfully. But thank you for getting me through my driving test.
That's, well, very welcome.
And watch out, road users. I'll be on that road soon, so careful. Thanks, I'll see you soon.
Well, here we are at Kimpton Primary School with Bill Williams, and this is the Comtel Community Care Programme. Bill, what's your role here?
Well, I'm the Andover Area School Liaison Officer, basically. I'm based at Weyhill Police Station, and my task is to basically go to 46 different schools in the Andover area, right the way up to Newbury, right the way down to King Somborne, Whitchurch across the Shipton Bellinger, and I do the Getting It Right programme to the school children in all those schools.
Yeah, I've seen your vehicle around actually too, isn't it? The good old 3H motors.
I was the first officer in Hampshire to get a sponsored motor vehicle, and without that, basically, I wouldn't have been able to do the job. So it's a godsend, really. Without that vehicle, I wouldn't be here today, really.
Okay. So what are you doing here today?
Right, I'm here at Kimpton School this afternoon to do the final lesson that they've had me all year. The children that we're going to see today, and as part of the end of the Getting It Right package, we've actually written a pantomime. It's based on Jack and the Beanstalk, and in the pantomime there are all the messages that we've given to every class over the last year, from solvent abuse right the way through road safety, bullying, and all sorts of general lessons like that, stranger danger, that sort of stuff. And all those have all been written into Jack and the Beanstalk, the pantomime. And halfway through the pantomime, the children actually have to show that they've learnt the golden rules by singing a song with the cast, and the song is called The Golden Rules. And the golden rules are basically five different rules that we've actually set within the lesson plans, so that at the end of each lesson we say, right, now what rule do we think will fit with that lesson, such as one of the golden rules is think before you do. The whole idea of Getting It Right is to give the children the choice of making sure that they keep themselves safe. Mum and dad aren't always there, nurses and doctors aren't always there, policemen and fire brigade aren't always there, and the children therefore have to know that it's their job to keep themselves safe. And they use the golden rules basically as a toolbox to say, think before you do, you can say no, that sort of stuff.
Well, I think that's something wonderful, really, for the community, and all credit to you and the Hampshire Police. So what we're going to do is follow you into the classroom. So if you'd like to show us away, we'll come up behind you. So after you.
Okay,
we'll follow you in there.
One, two, three. Getting it right together, keeping safe with you. Just remember that golden rule, think before you do. Just remember that golden rule, think before you do. Getting it right together, make a friend be kind. Just remember that golden rule, make up your own mind. Just remember that golden rule, make up your own mind. Getting it right together, stop the alarm bell rings. Just remember the golden rule, trust your own feelings. Just remember the golden rule, trust your own feelings. Getting it right together, more funny special you know. Just remember the golden rules, you can't say no. Just remember the golden rules, you can't say no. Getting it right together, growing up is what to do. Just remember the golden rule, ask for help if you need to. Just remember the golden rules, ask for help if you need to.
Well then, a real sense of good crack. Brilliant. That was very good indeed, okay? It's very important that you remember.
Is it fun banger racing?
Is it fun banger racing? Yes, indeed it is. Banger racing is one of those forms of motorsport that I do. I did mention earlier that I do two types of racing. Banger racing is the one that I do most of. And when I do the racing, I do it for charity. Okay, I always get an old scrapped car or an MOT failure which might not mean much to you, but basically it's a car that is no longer able to go on the road, okay? And there's a picture of the one up here. I've got an old Ford Capri here, which I did some racing last year for a charity called Baby Life Support Systems. It's a charity that buys all the special needs equipment for the special care baby units in different hospitals. And we took that one down to a racing track in North Devon, and basically we raced in about four or five races, and we raised about £470 in the end. But it is very enjoyable. It's very safe, okay, especially in Devon where we race. It's on grass, so the cars don't get too fast, okay. They tend to slide more than roll over, because when you race on a tarmac circuit, there's always a curb or something around the outside. And when you hit that, you end up going upside down, which isn't very nice at all. Okay, but in Devon, where we race on grass, it's fantastic, and it is so much fun. It's incredible. It really is. I'm doing it again in July with another car, and I'm raising money for a handicapped children's school in Exeter. So if you're in Devon at the end of July, you're more than welcome to come and watch. Any more? Okay, well, thank you for watching the Comtel Community Care Programme. It was fun for us all here to be part of it. If there are any questions out there that you would like to ask me as the school liaison officer with some of the stuff that I'm giving to or the lessons that I'm teaching to your children, please don't hesitate to call me at Weyhill Police Station.
Visit Sunflower and see the exciting new ranges of colourful clothing in this season's acid colours. Sarongs, dresses, skirts and tops for everyone. Visit us at 3 Bridge Street, Andover. Telephone number 01264 334416.
Hello, I'm Pam Callahan. My husband and I would like to welcome you to the Amport Inn in our thatch village with our trout stream. Hidden among the 9 bedrooms en suite is an indoor heated swimming pool. During the summer months, why not book for a swim at lunchtime? Dip and dine with us. Just call on 01264 710371.
Carefree holidays start at Bournemouth International Airport. Fly to your favourite destinations throughout Europe with reliable tour operators. Thompson, Islanders, Palm Air and Phoenix Holidays will take you there this summer. New for winter, Air Tours fly to Tenerife. Cosmos, Palm Air, Saga and Thompson to the favourite destinations. Ryanair now have a daily service to Dublin for only £59 return. Bournemouth International Airport, more to offer than ever before.
Hello, my name is Jerry Holt, owner of Magic Carpet, speaking to you from Winchester Street in Salisbury, and I'm going to show you how you can save a pile on carpets. For my next trick, we have got some special offers at £7.99 a square metre for bleach-proof and stain-proof carpet, with free gripper, free fitting and free door bars. Not funny, but good value for money. And don't forget, if you can't come to us, we'll come to you. If you enjoyed the advert, it's Jerry Holt at Magic Carpets. If you didn't, it's Paul Daniels.
I'm Ben Wilson with a roundup of the news from your premier weekly newspapers, the Andover Advertiser and Salisbury Journal. Speeding motorists got a lucky break this week during a 3-day campaign around Andover using the latest laser gun technology. 69 of the 157 speed trapped drivers got the chance to atone by watching an 8-minute video and discuss the implications of their driving. The remaining 88 had been going too fast to be offered the video viewing incentive and ended up with speeding tickets. Traffic Sergeant Nigel Palmer believes the campaign offering the chance to educate motorists is the future. One of Andover's biggest employers, GBE Leg, has been charged with conspiring to break UN sanctions by trying to trade with Serbia and Montenegro during the civil war in the former Yugoslavia. The Customs and Excise prosecution includes 13 other named local people and one other business and relates to sanctions issued between 1992 and 1995. All defendants are due back in court on the 17th of September. A Luggershaw pub landlord is threatening to publicly pillory a convicted burglar by showing security camera footage on the big screen bar. Mark Smith from the Crown Inn in Luggershaw said the aim of the public showing is to act as a deterrent to future burglars. Star of the video is 32-year-old John Sadler of Forest Drive, Tidworth, given 120 hours community service for his part in the burglary. Road rage motorist Neil David Cole has been sentenced to 8 weeks in jail after allegedly headbutting another driver after a crash in Greatley. The 35-year-old from Overwallop had pleaded guilty to common assault. Passing sentence, Magistrate Mr. Blake said higher courts had indicated to them tough sentences should be given in cases of this nature. A man died at an Andover substation after receiving a huge electric shock of 132,000 volts. 30-year-old Robert McElwee of Dorchester was working in Charlton Road to dismantle parts of the Southern Electric station. The Health and Safety Executive is investigating the accident and will send a report to the coroner. Peter Redmond found Weyhill's heart with his painstakingly researched play on the history behind the village's famous hiring and selling fair. A cast of millions has swirled through the sights through the century, but the Andover author managed to tell the story with a cast of just 100. Taking place at the rear of the Weyhill Fair, songs and dances were choreographed and a huge wardrobe of costumes assembled. Beware snares is the message from an Andover animal lover, horrified to discover a homemade device wrapped around a neighbour's cat. Susan Newman of Wool Grove believes that the pet became caught prowling along Ladies Walk, a popular haunt for cats and children. The wire could have done serious damage, she said. Torrential rain failed to dampen spirits as cheering and flag-waving crowds lined the streets on Saturday to enjoy the Andover Carnival. Nominated theme was All the Fun of the Fair, leading to a host of imaginative floats which set the town alight with colour. The sport was incredible. Everyone was still cheering and larking around despite the appalling weather, said Peter Walker of the organising Andover Roundtable. Brutal killers Justin Rainey and Timothy Kerwin began life sentences this week after a jury found them guilty of the motiveless murder of Eddie Harkins at Salisbury Fair last October. Earlier, the jury at Winchester Crown Court had heard evidence from eyewitnesses on the attack of Harkins. One of the defendants, Timothy Kerwin, publicly apologised for the teenager's death at the end of the cross-examination. Culver Street Car Park is to reopen at the end of this month, bringing an end to Salisbury's car parking misery. The multi-storey closed in February for an £850,000 facelift, which was expected to take until the end of July, but damage by vandals in May delayed completion. Two Salisbury men were killed last week when their car hit a tree outside the Wood Valley home of rock star Sting. Mark Loveridge, who was driving, died at the scene, and his companion David Colking shortly after reaching Salisbury District Hospital. The deaths marked another black week on South Wiltshire's roads, which had claimed three lives the week before. A pilot and her passenger had a miraculous escape on Monday when their twin-engine light aircraft crashed into a cornfield south of Tisbury. Rosalind Doseray from Ringwood and Sean Penton from Alderholt suffered only cuts and bruises. It is believed that the six-seat Beechcraft Baron had a problem with its fuel tanks but did not catch fire when it hit the ground. Ambitious plans to give a £2 million facelift to Salisbury Arts Centre are being backed by district councillors. They voted to commit more than £250,000 to the project to support the centre's bid for a £1.5 million award from the National Lottery. A prankster who severed the head of John the Baptist at Salisbury Cathedral to keep as a souvenir has been told to pay the full cost of the repair. Richard Medway Gash risked his neck to climb 30 feet up scaffolding on the west front where restoration work was being carried out. He told police he had no idea of the value of the statue. City magistrates also conditionally discharged him for 6 months and ordered him to pay £50 costs. Salisbury's Olympic Appeal Committee handed over a cheque for £15,000 to the chairman of the National Appeal, Geoffrey Maitland-Smith, this week. The presentation was made at a champagne reception at Longford Castle, hosted by the Earl and Countess of Radnor. Around £8,000 of the total was raised by a 24-hour rowing marathon held at Salisbury Leisure Centre in February. Sport and seven master swimmers from Salisbury ASC were in action at the 6th World Masters Swimming Championships in Sheffield. Medals are awarded down to 10th place at world level, and the Salisbury squad, with some excellent individual performances, succeeded in bringing home a very impressive 7 medals. And finally, Laverstoke dad Russell Jugg delivered his impatient second daughter in the family bathroom, just like his firstborn 2 years ago. Baby Philippa couldn't wait for the midwife on June the 30th, and in 1994, big sister Charlotte made her entry before Russell could get wife Bronwyn to hospital. This has been the news from the Andover Advertiser and Salisbury Journal. I'm Ben Wilson reporting.
Changing the weather.
It's very hot, isn't it? My sinuses are playing me up.
This is unreal. I mean, a few days ago it was bucketing down at the end of Carnival, and here we are, still on the steps of this hotel in Amesbury. It's absolutely beautiful. It's scorching, wearing all the wrong clothes. Somebody rang me up from Salisbury, I think it was Tony, not this one, rang up and said, look, why don't you feed poor Tony up? Tony Murray, that is, because you're always out in restaurants, all these glamorous women. Mm. This is me.
Yes.
And Tony always misses out. So eating out is in. And actually, in fact, staying out's in as well, because we're at this hotel.
Yeah.
We had an invite from the Fairlawn Hotel, didn't we?
Well, I'm surprised I got to come here.
Well, you know.
Thanks very much, Al.
I can't have you getting thin.
Oh, right. Yeah. I'm looking forward to a meal for a change.
They've got a cellar bar here. Would you believe that? In the middle of Amesbury, the Fairlawn Hotel. Cellar. Italian English food.
I've just had a quick look at it. I don't know what the food is like yet, but I've just had a quick look at the restaurant. I think it's beautiful. It really is a lovely place.
I bet they've got some nice Chianti or something. You know, we can do a sort of Keith Floyd impersonation.
Jason's driving, of course.
So we're going to be really good boys. We're going to go in and have a look at this place because it's great to come out to places like Amesbury. You know, don't go to all those places on the A303, you know, all these modern places.
Yeah.
Come to a family hotel, you know, the true traditional family hotel in Amesbury.
This is great. I really am enjoying myself tonight.
Okay. Right. We're going inside. That's enough of us waffling on. I'm going to fatten Tony up.
Yeah, we catch you inside, Jay.
See you later. Bye. There you are, see them tucked away behind the facade of the high street, is a lovely quiet lounge. It's wonderful. I feel like Lloyd Grossman going into people's homes. It's really quite good, actually. Look, Jason, there's lovely wallpaper and curtains, and there's an old sea dog up behind me. It's quite amazing. It's a beautiful place, obviously an old Georgian building. It's really, really lovely. You see, nice to come to these places. Lovely little marble busts there, and nice bit of furniture. Really nice. I wonder what else we'll find.
Right, this is wonderful in here. I'm sitting in the lounge and it's what a wonderful place. It's so comfortable. Although Alan said he's taking me out for a meal tonight. We're going to have that later. He's going to go down in and talk to Paul, the chef, and the owner of the place, the co-owner of the place, but I want to talk to Doreen Banks now, who's the lady of the house. Now, you've been here 10 years, and this is the reason we came.
Yes, that's right.
Have you enjoyed the 10 years?
Yes, we have.
What were you doing before that?
We had a supermarket, which we owned and ran. It became 7 days a week, and we decided that we'd like to move on and do something different.
Well, it's got to be 7 days a week here as well.
Yeah, but more enjoyable, 7 days a week.
So when did you decide, right, we're going to get a hotel?
Well, just over 10 years ago. Paul said he would like a pub to begin with, and I said, no, I didn't. I didn't fancy the idea of having a pub. So he then said, well, would you like a hotel? And I said, well, it's a bit more appealing than a pub. So we came and looked at this hotel, the first hotel we looked at it.
This is the first one you looked at?
Yeah, and we liked the atmosphere, and we both fell in love with it. So we said, this is the one.
Love at first sight?
Yeah, you could say that.
Well, you know, I've just been walking around, and you've got a lovely little lounge bar in here where I've had a small little bit of a refreshment, and all these the guys in there, they love it. They come in here every night, don't they?
Yes, they do.
So it's not just residents that come into the bar,
no,
is it?
Lots of other people come in, some on a regular basis now. We've got to know a few people around Amesbury, and we have a few good evenings together.
So you're going to stay here? Are you going to expand and buy other hotels, or you just
no,
want to?
I don't think so.
This is enough for you?
This is enough.
And it keeps you working full time?
Keeps me working full time, definitely.
Well, what's your main clientele? Is it business people or tourists?
Both. Hmm. Both, because we do get lots of people on business, and we get the tourists once the summer trade comes. During the winter, it's mostly business people.
Well, you're so close to Stonehenge, I suppose a lot of people come to see that.
That's right, yes, they do, and Salisbury Cathedral and Boatsheim.
What we're going to do is we're not going to wait for another 10 years, but we will come back in another 10 years, and it'll be lovely to come back and see.
Oh, that'd be very nice.
If we're still here.
If we're still here, yes.
The food's ready.
Jason,
the food is ready down here, so I'm going to go and film Paul doing it. That's going to be fun, isn't it?
Well, you better take this microphone with you.
Yes, okay. Thanks for talking to us. Was he all right? He didn't give you a grilling, did he? That was a pun. All right, I'll see you. See you in the restaurant. Bye.
Follow me into these hallowed acres of this kitchen below the street in Amesbury. Paul Banks, this is your life.
Hi there.
I'm doing very well. What are you going to do for us tonight?
I'm going to make you a carbonara.
A what?
Carbonara, Italian dish.
And what's that?
Well, it's basically based on a white sauce, mm-hmm. With smoked bacon in it,
yep.
Black peppers,
yep.
Italian seasonings, mm-hmm. A bit of garlic, and a little bit of parsley.
Well, I'll come around this side out of the way, so you can actually
show you
look at that. What's that?
This is a smoked bacon.
Smoked bacon?
Which is going to go into the white sauce.
Yep.
Okay, I'm going to put that in.
Yep.
A little stir.
Lovely smell of herbs and things. It's down here, isn't it?
That's right. It's very nice. Yeah. Bit of black pepper.
Black pepper going in.
Bit of Italian seasoning.
Italian seasoning, right?
A little touch of garlic.
Garlic.
And a wee bit of parsley.
Last time Jason and I were in a kitchen together, we were in Andover, Massachusetts, weren't we, Jason? And we went to this wonderful restaurant on the Phillips Academy. It was a great place. That was really good fun. But this is wonderful. There's this great, wonderful garlic smells.
Yes, right. This would be a really nice dish. We'll get that on the stove.
Get that heated up.
Right.
Put some spaghetti on.
Spaghetti's going on, right. In goes the spaghetti. Any special recipe for that? Or?
No. This has already been pre-cooked.
Oh, right.
And we're just going to reheat it back up.
Yep.
It's been cooked with a little bit of seasoning, yep. And salt, a bit of pepper. Yep.
What's the things you're asked for in Amesbury, Paul? You know, what's the most popular stuff?
This is one of the popular dishes. We've got a big menu, and I'm glad to say that everything on the menu goes very, very well. Very, very well indeed.
I didn't know it was an Italian restaurant in Amesbury. I really didn't.
Well, actually, there was actually a restaurant on its own,
yeah.
Which is an Italian restaurant, and,
yeah.
And unfortunately, it closed down.
Yeah.
And we decided we would take the Italian over, as nobody else was going to do it in Italian anymore.
Yeah, but you're English and Italian, aren't you?
We're English and Italian. We do both.
Okay, brilliant. There's not one in Andover, I know that for sure. But this looks great.
We'll give that a nice stir again.
Okay.
Get it heated up well.
Yep. Nice and hot.
When it's cooked off, we'll mix the spaghetti with it.
Yep.
And then we'll put it in some dishes.
Yep.
And we'll top it with some nice cheese and grill it off over the grill.
So this is 10 years tonight, isn't it, here?
That's right, yes. We've been here 10 years tonight.
That's a great success story, though, isn't it? You've fought through the recession, you're still here.
That's right, yes. We've done very well, I think. We've refurbished the hotel 3 times since we've been here. The last time was approximately about a year ago, which took us 11 months to complete. But we're very, very pleased with the result. And I feel that all our customers are now, as same customers keep coming back all the time.
You know what we haven't got, don't you?
The wine.
We didn't get any glass of wine, did we? But I'm sure we can rectify that.
That's no problem.
While you're cooking that, I think we're going to go find a glass of wine in the best Keith Floyd tradition.
Thank you very much.
Paul, thank you very much. We'll be back in just a second.
Okay.
I've been told it's ready. I'm going to take Paul a bottle of this most beautiful Domaine bottle Chablis, 1991, for him to taste as well. It's delicious. So I brought you a bottle of Chablis. Look.
Oh, that's very decent.
I think you need this. And working.
Yeah,
look at you. You've got a sweat up in there.
Okay.
So this looks absolutely wonderful.
Well, I hope you're going to enjoy it.
So how did you prepare that? That was done behind the scenes, really, wasn't it? I mean, it's really, really good. Look at it. What a presentation.
I think you'll enjoy it.
Yeah.
As I said earlier, all the ingredients that went into it after you left, I've just put an extra little bit of seasoning in and a little bit more cream, put some more cheese in, and now it's ready for you to taste.
Paul, thank you very much and congratulations on 10 years. Absolutely amazing. So we're going to go to the table now. Thank you very much indeed. Okay. He's behind me. This is it. Live on TownTV. You know, I said about Tony Murray never eating anything. Well, of course, we're having a little evening this evening, Tony and myself. Struth. We're not going to be talked about, are we?
Food at last.
Food at last. There we are. There's a Chablis 1991, Domaine bottled. Look at this food.
Oh,
this is absolutely wonderful.
Gorgeous.
One for the cameraman. So, Jason, we're just going to tuck into this. So, you know,
I mean, we're 3 years old now as a television company.
That's right.
Is it going to be 3 years before I get fed again?
Oh, probably. But this restaurant's, this hotel's 10 years old. Isn't that good? Let's have a little go.
Let's have a taste of this.
A nice little bit of side to go with it.
No.
A little bit, that's huge.
Well, there is three of them.
Thank you, Paul.
Paul, thank you very much indeed.
Right. This Enjoy your meal.
Wonderful, thank you.
Mmm.
What do you think?
Oh, that's excellent.
Bit of cream, bit of garlic.
Have you been there while it's all been cooked?
Do you think you're going to fatten up now?
Who said that?
I need to fatten up, don't I? Yes.
Anyway, thanks for watching the show. Don't forget this place has got a great disco, I've been told, which we're going to probably film in a minute. It's also, what else has it got? It's got all sorts of things, patios, a whole lot. All I say, it's a great, great family business. And that's what we're all about on TownTV, promoting the local community. So thanks for watching us eat this, which is great. And Tony, you're not going to be thin after all.
I never was in the first place. But I really am enjoying this. This is terrific.
Thanks for watching the show. We'll see you later. Bye for now. Right, well, the aircraft are moving out in formation now. And Phamie is going to go off in the lead crunchy. They're coming down the runway now. Incredible sight. The waving. Phamie's waving. Incredible sight. There they go. Well, I think she deserves a medal.
Windswept.
Okay, well, that was the most fantastic experience of my whole life. I can't believe you do this for a living.
It's brilliant, isn't it?
Oh, it's just one, the most adrenaline-inducing thing. I'd like to say thank you so much to Vic. Thank you, Vic.
Pleasure. Real.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
Tania. Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Helen.
You're welcome.
All
right.
It's all been wonderful. You've looked after me really well. Where can people see you next? Where will you be?
We will be at Yeovilton, actually, which is not very far away, this coming Saturday. Right. So we will be there.
Ah, the ship. This won't get on that show, will it? We won't be too late to know about that.
We're at Fairford, which is a
international
huge show.
Air tattoo.
Yeah.
Excellent. On TV last night. So.
Brilliant. Well, thank you so, so much. If you ever need a wing walker again, I'd pack my job in and come follow you wherever you are.
We remember you said that.
Absolutely.
Thanks a lot. That was brilliant. Thank you.
Well, before we leave Popham Airfield, I'd like to introduce you to Dick Richardson, the airfield manager here. Morning, Dick.
Morning.
A wonderful day here with the Crunchies flying in.
Very nice, very nice. Well, the lads have been here before with the aeroplanes. We're delighted to see them. Yeah, they've had a bit of spice to the airfield.
Tell the viewers who don't know, where is Popham Airfield?
It's on the A303. It's sort of between Basingstoke and Andover.
It's a lovely location. What does it cost to fly here?
Well, I should point out that all the aircraft here are privately owned. It's a private airfield and a recreational facility. Not much happens during the week. Mm-hmm. It's a weekend. The place comes alive at weekends.
You have lots of clubs flying in, don't guest appearances by aircraft and different things, is that right?
All sorts. Yeah. Every month we have a fly-in of one sort or another. This weekend, for example, we've got a host of foreigners coming over from the continent and Sweden with their aeroplanes. Yeah, it's great fun, great fun.
And can you have flying lessons from here?
No, you can't. We're an unlicensed aerodrome, so flying training cannot take place other than the microlighting. You can do that on an unlicensed airfield.
But people who can fly can buy a share of an aircraft and fly from here?
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely, yeah. We've got about 100 aircraft based here now.
Really?
Absolutely, yeah.
Will you do maintenance here as well?
Just a little bit, just over here, a small maintenance setup, yeah.
Absolutely fantastic. So what's for the future? You're not going to put a runway in on?
No. We're going to stay exactly the way we are. We're a very popular little grass airfield. We want to keep it that way.
Okay, splendid. Thanks for letting us come in with the Crunchies this morning.
It's been our pleasure. Okay, thanks.
Smashing. Thanks very much. Are you feeling a bit fuller now, after that meal?
Look at me. I'm getting fatter by the week.
It was a great pass there, wasn't it?
Well, it's the only time you ever took me out for a meal.
Be careful. People will be talking about us.
You get all the good jobs, all the meal jobs, and a drop of wine every now and then.
I know.
Mm.
But I didn't go wingwalking, did I? No. No. Well done to Phamie McDonald for doing that. What a brave soul she is.
She was great. She was great.
Not many people would do that, and she did a great job, didn't she?
She did, indeed.
Yeah. And you can challenge Phamie by bringing in to us and ask her what she wants to do next. That could be fun. North face of the Eiger.
Well, she might just do that.
She might do that.
Yeah.
Anyway, on with the competitions. We're going to roll this one over. I'll tell you why. Because Country Music TV, our good friends up there, has sent us down two wonderful real denim crystal springs. Look at that. Denim shirts. Now, these are made in America. They're 100% cotton. They are fantastic. I feel like a market trader.
Well, you do, but they are good quality, boy.
These are about £70. These are amazing.
They are excellent.
And if you win one of those, it's going to be fantastic. So we're going to roll over the competition together with a £50 meat voucher from Alan Gardner of Luggershaw, together with a VH1 Artist of the Month T-shirt, and the third prize is also the VH1 Artist of the Month T-shirt. So we're going to add those two to it. And the question was, again, Anthea Turner used to be the National Lottery presenter. Who is a new one?
I'm not going to tell you.
Bruce Forsyth? Des O'Connor? Or Bob Monkhouse? So ring us on 390. Or Salisbury 555.
222.
Or send us a fax on 390.
391.
Or write to us at PO Box 555 Andover. So just do that right now. Anthea Turner used to be the National Lottery presenter. Who is a new one? Bruce Forsyth, Des O'Connor, or Bob Monkhouse? And these prizes are probably adding up to about, I don't know what, £200-300. So it's really, really good value. So get on the phone right now. If you haven't gone in for the comp, you can go in again. We'll put you in twice into the golden bucket, won't we?
Yeah, why not? Let's do it again.
Yeah, that'd be really great. We're going to be in Salisbury on the, when is it?
The 20th.
The 20th. That's a Saturday.
Yeah, Saturday, Saturday the 20th, yes. So we'll be there with the roadshow.
The roadshow in the Old George Mill. So all you people who want to sing karaoke, just ring us up. Tell us what you want to sing. We've got 1,600 songs you can choose from.
Oh, I know. And I know every one of them.
You do, yeah. We'll probably sing Love Is All Around Again.
Probably.
Yeah, but we'll be there. Probably from about 11 o'clock in the Old George Mill in Salisbury. That's on next Saturday, the 20th. So we'll be there. Thanks to the
Old George. It was great fun the last time we did it. I really enjoyed it.
You were really good.
Well, it was the first karaoke that we'd actually done without playing as a band.
You look like a pop star. You are a pop star.
I thought, like, karaoke, no. Yeah. But I really got into it and I really enjoyed it, and everybody seemed to enjoy it. We've had so many phone calls asking us when we're doing it again. So that's it, the 20th.
We'll be there. So the Old George Mill, be there, all of you. So I guess that's about it for this week. Hopefully we're going to do Andover in the High Street on the 24th of August, but sorry about the rain. It wasn't really our fault, was it? Mm.
It was a shame, really, yeah. Because as soon as we set up and started playing, down it came.
We're raising a lot of money for charity on Town TV, so thanks for watching the show. We'll see you all again next week, OK? Bye for now.
Cheers now.
Bye.
By the Met Office at Southampton Weather Centre. Saturday, mostly cloudy but dry and warm with occasional bright or sunny intervals and light southwest winds. Maximum temperature 21 Celsius. Sunday, mostly cloudy in the morning, then sunny spells developing from the north. Light west winds and a maximum temperature of 23 Celsius. The outlook for the rest of the week, dry and warm with sunny spells, though the winds will gradually pick up to a fresh easterly. Maximum temperatures around 22 Celsius.